he will be delivering his second session on our MA Economics second semester course on economic development. The unit today is quite interesting. The blocks that he will be discussing is block I, where we have the classical theories of development that covers the contributions of Adam Smith, Ricardo, Malthus, J.S. Mill, and things like that. Further, we have the contribution of Schumpeter, where he would be discussing the contribution of Schumpeter, where he talks about innovation and economic growth. Subsequently, there is also the contribution of populations in economic growth. There are many contributors there, like Louis, Harris Tadaro, and many more. Without taking much of your time, I would like to invite Tapan sir to handle the session.
The floor is yours. Thank you, Dr. Asis. Good afternoon, dear friends. As Dr. Asis told, it is block 5, theories of development. Here, we shall cover three units, that is classical theories of development, Schumpeter and classical development, and population and development. That is unit 16, 17, and 18. So let me begin with the theories of development, classical theory of development. So here we shall discuss about the contribution of our father of economies, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, Malthus, J.S. Mill. This group of economists are called classical economists. Anyway, after this session, you will be able to know what is economic development, classical theory of economic development. Here, we can distinguish the contribution made by the great economists like Adam Smith, Ricardo, Malthus, Mill, and Marx. And here, we can also compare the contribution of different economists, the different type of contribution they have made. And here, we shall analyze the critically what are the weaknesses of each of the theory. Anyway, the classical theory or classical thought or classical school that is headed by Adam Smith, Malthus, David Ricardo, and J.S. Mill. It is a concrete theory, classical theory. Here, we shall come across certain fundamental things, and we may reach to the same conclusion. And the classical theories of development, we shall discuss together the contribution made by different economies. In unison, we shall discuss about their contribution. One question, there are certain fundamental assumptions or fundamental conditions by which the classical theory is based on. First of all, you have to understand certain fundamental things like the basic assumptions like the primary assumption of the theory, classical theory of economic development is laissez-faire. Laissez-faire means here, let the individual do alone. Here, you'll find minimum role of the states. The state will not of production. It is the individual to decide what to produce, how to produce, what to produce, how much to produce, or most the central problem of economy that is mainly decided by the individual. And here, the role of the government is minimum. So that is the primary criteria on which the classical theory of economic development is based on. Second important question we'll have to discuss in the classical theory of economic development is here that there is a perfect competition. One of the basic assumptions of the classical theory of development is perfect competition. Though there are many criticisms to perfect competition, but they say that Adam Smith told that there is a the market force of demand and supply, that free flow of demand and supply, no restriction of demand and supply. And normally we said that there is a natural law, or what we call the invisible hand. Invisible hand. I mean, the market will decide everything, and there is no imposition from the side of the government. And the third and the most important question under under the classical theory is what? Capital accumulation. So you know that out of many factors of production, the labor, capital, and organization, Adam Smith told that why that is the output, that is determined by three important factors. One is the L equal to labor, K equal to capital, and T equal to land. So the primary factors of production, one of the factor of production is your capital. Capital, you know that that part of the wealth which is used for production purpose, that is called capital. And capital is the lifeblood of production. Capital accumulation, capital come from saving. And saving is that part of the income which we do not consume. So saving leads to accumulation of capital. And when more and more capital is there and investment can take place, and when more and more investment can take place, automatically there is more production and economic development is possible. So capital accumulation is a primary criteria for every, that is the classical economy from David Ricardo. If you land is the most important concept, like the physiocrats or the mercantilists, the view that capital is a primary thing. And the fourth important question we'll have to discuss here is the profit. Under classical theory or any theory, you know that whenever somebody is working, entrepreneur is working because profit is a primary consideration. When there is no profit, nobody will, no entrepreneur will not be interested to work. So profit is a reward. Profit is a reward for the entrepreneurial work. So we or any entrepreneur, whether big or small or anybody else, so they work only because there is certain amount of profit. So profit is a primary condition. For classical economies, we do not work when there is no profit. So profit plays a very vital role or primary role in the process of production. Then there is another very important, interesting question, they view the tendency of profit. What is the tendency of profit? The tendency of profit is first, initially it will increase, then automatically it is going to decrease, or the declining tendency of profit. Profit is the tendency of profit is declining. Automatically it will come to a halt, and automatically the capitalist or the market, everybody will be punished when the tendency of profit is going to fall. Then finally, the view that there is a stationary state. So remember that stationary. When we define this stationary state, or it is a state where the growth rate is constant. So remember, there is a basic difference between the stationary in physics and stationary in economics. In physics, stationary means something which is not moving. But in economics, stationary implies a condition where the rate of growth is same. For example, the growth rate of India, for example. Suppose it is 5% for a long period of time. I mean, the economy is growing. It is growing at a rate of 5%. So that is a stationary growth. Or suppose when you are riding a motorcycle going from Bargarh to Sambalpur, or Sambalpur to Jharsuguda, or somewhere else, with a constant speed of 5%, 50 kilometers per hour, then that is a stationary. So after a stationary state, a situation, economic development will not be like a tree. It will not, according to them, it will, after a particular point of time, that the development, the process of development will be halt. And that is another important criteria. So remember, just I'm making some of the assumptions of the different classical thought. One is the laissez-faire economy. There is a perfect competition in the economy. Minimum role of the government was the laissez-faire economy told. And another question is that it is a closed economy. Closed economy means it is a three-sector economy. There is C plus I plus, there is G. There is consumption plus investment plus government. And remember that there is no X minus M in or no external trade. So the country is free from trade, or there is no external trade in such situation. So there is every tendency that initially the profit will increase. After a point of time, it will decline. So this is the concept of economic development given by classical economics. But remember, all the economists I have pointed out, Arnold Smith, Malthus, David Ricardo, G.S. Mill, and they have defined this concept in different way, but leading to the same level, same type of conclusion. For example, when we go to Arnold Smith, you know, in his theory, he has given much more importance to the concept of the invisible hand, or what we call the natural law. Invisible hand means the free flow of market demand and supply that determine everything. The market will correct itself automatically. Automatic correction. For the Keynes criticized very severely that automatic correction is not possible. Another very important concept Adam Smith has given, the concept of division of labor. Remember, division of labor increase the productivity, which depends upon the size of the market. So when there is more division labor, specialization will come forward, and a particular when a laborer will be trained and automatically the process of production will be more when there is a division of labor. Then when we talk about this process of capital accumulation, Adam Smith viewed that when there is a division of labor leads to capital accumulation, and capital accumulation leads to ecomentum. Remember this particular word. Hello. So am I visible? I'm visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're visible, sir.
Yes,
please continue.
Anyway, that the process, when we talk about the process of capital accumulation, division of labor, capital accumulation, and capital accumulation leads to economic development. That is the view given by Adam Smith. Then, remember another very important, interesting question he raised, that why capitalists make investment? What is the need? By who is the capitalist investment? Capitalist invest. Investment is made to earn the profit. As I told you earlier in the introduction, profit is a driving force. So when there is no profit, no investment is possible, and greater and greater amount of profit requires, or automatically investment will increase when there is a question of profit. Then another question, what are the this question of this process which stop the profit? When the tendency of profit decline, investment come down. When investment decrease, automatically production will decrease. And when production will come down, then automatically employment will decrease. And when employment falls, the income of the people will decrease. And when there is a falling level of income, automatically the capitalist will not be interested in doing that. So this is a type of vision Adam Smith has given in his classical theory of labor. But remember that when we talk about the view of Adam Smith, certain thing we'll have to, it is very beyond our capacity to digest. For example, existence of perfect competition. Perfect competition is a myth. You cannot rely upon perfect competition always, and it is not possible. Somewhere there is a monopoly element in the economy. Then it is definitely the division of labor, as Adam Smith told, that greater and greater division of labor leads to more amount of profit, but the environment may not be conducive always. The division of labor is possible, and automatically more and more profit will be possible. And another very important question, that who is going to save? According to Adam Smith, it is the capitalist, landlord, and money lenders, they say. But you know that everybody saves something. Marx, in his letter on which I'll come into his theory, Marx viewed, capitalist is not safe always. We, the common man, with the laborer, with the small ways are not, we also save something. We save in the bank, somewhere else. And that saving is taken by this class of people, those who are called the capitalist class of people. So saving is not made by the money lender or somewhere else. So another question is that this theory neglects the role of entrepreneur, the primary things. Later on, we shall come across the view of Schumpeter. If you entrepreneur is the primary things, who takes the production decision, who innovates the thing. But here, you, Adam Smith has not given much more importance to him. Then another question, the stationary state. If you that Smith is of the view that the end result of capitalism, capitalist economy is stationary state, but it is not possible. So this is a type of view given by Adam Smith, but it is very difficult to digest the classical theory. But remember, till now there is much relevance of the theory, classical theory. It is a classic theory, like the classical dance, Odyssey, something else. It is a classic theory, so it is a classical theory. If you go to dictionary meaning of classical, classical does not mean only the old version. Sometimes we refer it as the old version. But that concept is very concrete concept. That reason we call it a classical theory. Later on, you know that economist like David Ricardo, one of the pioneer of economists from France, that in his book, The Principle of Political Economy and Taxation, he viewed that the same view. He has given the same view, but discussion is something in different way. Leading to the same conclusion, but the road is different. What do you mean? His main feature of theory, that Ricardian theory of economic development, is that three important question, main feature is one, that rent, profit, and purchase. And view, rent is that part of the produce of the earth which is paid to the landlord for the use of original and indestructible power of the soil. You might have gone through this definition in your micro theory. So land is a primary thing which has the surplus. It is the surplus, the marginal land and intra-marginal land, that difference between both the two, that leads to the physocrat concept. Second important question I will give, that the wage rate is determined by the wage form. Wage fund, a particular, there is a fund which is meant for the laborer or the wage earner, and the demand and supply of the wage fund that determine the wage. And the third important question is your profit. Profit is again a driving force which encourages the entrepreneur to produce more and more. So this is the primary concept. Secondly, he has given the same concept of your capital accumulation, and capital accumulation come from three important concepts here. One is the profit rate, higher the rate of profit, more will be the capital accumulation. And another question is, when there is an increase in the wages, when the wage rate goes up, the two things will face. When you are going to pay more and more to the factors of production, the share of the enterprise will come down. One. But when we pay more and more wages to the worker, more and more wages to the worker, they will get more income, they will spend more money, there will be more demand of the goods and services in the market. So we can discuss the wages in both the sides. Then the wage rate increase when the price of commodity forming the subsistence of the wage worker increases. Another question, that again, the profit of when there is a competition or something else, perfect competition is there, when there is no monopoly element, the profit tendency is going to decline. That is the view given by David Ricardo. Another question. Another important sources of capital accumulation is taxes. When taxes are the source of capital accumulation in the hand of the government, you individual or myself or yourself or Dr. Rasis, we cannot impose tax. It is the government which imposes the tax, and the source, it is one of the most important source of the income of the government. And according to Ricardo, taxes are to be levied to reduce the conspicuous consumption, I mean the luxury goods. So more and more taxes are to be levied, particularly for the conspicuous consumption. Otherwise, the imposition of tax on capitalists, landlord and laborer will transfer resources from those groups to the government, adversely affect the income. It means when we impose more and more amount of taxes to the rich people, that there is a diversion of resources from the haves class to the pocket of the government. Transfer of resources from the pocket of the government, a pocket of the have class to the pocket, and that may that might discourage. Heavy taxation, you know, discourage willing, as Dalton told once, that the willingness to work, willingness to save, ability to work, ability to save, that will come down when more and more taxes is. Then another source of capital formation is your free trade. When there is a free trade, automatically that more and more thing is possible. And Ricardo, that there is an view, capital accumulation is the result of free trade. Then again, that is finally a situation will come when it will reach to the stationary state. And after the stationary state, when the growth rate remain constant, suppose it is 5% for a continuous period of time, or 2% for a continuous period of time, or 2% or 1% over a long period of time, automatically that will decrease the interest of the enterprise class, and the economy will come to an end or halt. So that is the type of view given by David Ricardo. Again, the same type of criticism you will find, you can read here, the absence of impact of technology has been neglected. And it is given that the business, the population factor is not taken into consideration, or there is a unnecessary importance is given to the law of diminishing return. For example, in India, we have seen that after independence, during that time, 1950s, the food production was just 50 million tons. And today it is 295 million tons. So even if the Adam Smith viewed that the diminishing return will operate quickly, but we have not imagined diminishing return will not apply like a machine. When we change the technology, when we adopt new concept of production, diminishing return is not going to cut your throat. So these are certain type of criticism that is leveled against him. So normally these are two important theory. And another two important theory that give to your demand side of theory. In the last session, we have discussed about a very important concept of Malthusian theory, Malthus, T.R. Malthus. A very popular theory, classical theory, T.R. Malthus has given in his famous work. If you, the impact of population. So as you know that in the Malthusian theory of population, the last class I told you, the population, the food production will grow at arithmetical progression, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But population will increase in a geometrical progression, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. And after a point of time, after a period of time, the growth of population will be much more higher than the growth rate of the food production. So Malthusian hypothesis is given important, particularly with respect to the impact of population upon economic development. The population plays an important role in the economic development. Remember, when the growth rate of population is more than the growth rate of the food production, or let me tell you the GDP, gross domestic product. When the rate of growth of population is more than the rate of growth of GDP, then the standard of living will decrease. When both will increase at the same rate, again reaching to the stationary state. But remember, when the growth rate of the GDP is greater than that of your population, the economic development is possible. So there are three important concepts. And yes, pointed out here, when we talk about the concept of economic development, Malthus has given a very important and interesting concept. What is that? That it is the economic development has a parallel link to it, population growth. In the initial stage, when income is very less, the country is very poor, the GDP is very less, no economic development is taking place, or what we call in the Rostos view, when we are in the pre-Newtonian era, before Newton, when science has not taken place, economic development is not taking place. In such a situation, the birth rate as well as death rate is very, very, almost all both are same. And when the birth rate and death rate both are same, automatically the growth rate is less, But remember, economic development is not taking place. Over a period of time, when the GDP will grow, economic development will take place, and the concept of population, the second stage of demographic transition, what we have discussed. So this will lead to certain changes, but in the third stage, when the birth rate is less, death rate is less, automatically the economic development in the developed country like European country or America or Japan or somewhere else, the population growth is very less. And population plays an important role in shaping the economy or for economic development. Population is very, but remember, excessive growth of population will lead to destruction. The economy will reach to the stationary state, or even the falling tendency starts when there is a concept of heavy population growth. But remember, as I told you in the last class, that in the Malthusian theory, the nature will take its own care. The natural factor like your diseases, like corona today, what we are just interestingly we have seen that some disease, war, famines, so naturally it will just reduce the population. Second important concept is, according to Malthus, that when we adopt some artificial way of controlling population like late marriage, abortion, or use of medicine, contraceptives, this also artificial way we can able to control the population. So population plays a very important role in the economic development according to Malthus. So similarly, if you'll go to another very popular concept given by J.S. Mill. Remember, I'm just repeating that all the classical economists based on same objection, leading to the same conclusion, but the way of discussion is something separate. Somebody that Adam Smith has given excessive importance to division of labor, whereas Ricardo has given importance to the contribution of rent. And here, Malthus has given importance to the population factor. So here, another concept, the concept given by J.S. Mill is your population and the working force. Remember, the whole population is not working force. Working force here means a particular age group of people, for example, 50 to 59, the working population. So remember, population, suppose India is a country, we are discussing that it is the youngest country of the world, having the largest amount of young people below 35 years. But remember, here the concept of working population, the percentage of working population is comparatively less. We have a greater and greater number of what? The consuming population, consumer, what we call the, for example, the age group between 0 to 14. So that is called the consumer, the child population, or above the age group of, let us say, 60. They contribute around 50%. It means out of the whole, and out of the rest 50%, some are not working, some are working, unemployed, these guys unemployed, or different type of unemployment is there. So as a whole, we have a huge population. Population is an asset for the country, but majority of the population of our country, they are not working. Out of, I told you that in a family of five, only two are working and three are consuming. So there is a very important and interesting concept, working force concept, that was discussed by J.S. Mill. Then another question is the technological investment. Investment and technology. When technology, Mill states that the role of capital in the process, production process, and when there is a greater and more investment in the technological investment, like creating of your fixed capital, like machinery and other, that will bring a more and more profit to the concept. And finally, again, the concept of business cycle come down, first it will increase, reaches to the maximum, after a point of time, the depression will start, and finally, economy will reach to a situation, what we call the depressed economy, and the business cycle is complete. So these are some of the important contributions made by the classical economists. So remember, I'm just making a summary of the classical theory. So classical theory is based on the concept of, first important concept is your capital, how accumulation is capital is possible. Second important question is, the tendency of profit. We work only for profit. Third question is the tendency of profit is declining, and the concept of stationary state. When stationary state, we reach to the state of stationary state, again, the economy will come to a standstill and economic development is halt and the capitalist economy is finished. So these are certain type of discussion made by the classical economists. Anyway, when we discuss about the theory of economic development, now we shall switch over to the another important concept, that is the Marxian theory of economy. Karl Marx, you know that very popular name, like Marxism, the concept he has given in his famous book, The Capital, or what we call the Das Kapital. Marx, you know that one economist, a philosopher, somebody, some people say that Marx is a prophet, like we follow the Jesus or Mohammedan or Hindu. So Marxism is a religion. There are many people who view Marx is much misunderstood than he understood. So anyway, Marx is a religion. Remember, classical, two important economists I shall point out. One is Keynes and another is Marx. They have created class of their own. For example, classical economy. When we talk about classical economy, there's a bunch of economists are there, like Adam Smith or David Ricardo, what I told. Another concept is your neoclassical. There are another group of economists, Marshall and others. But Marx has its own class. And similarly, Keynes. Keynesian economy, Marxian economy. So these are two separate class of economy. So let me come to the Marxian theory of development. Remember, as I told that the time constant is a very important factor here. Anyway, just we will have to look in detail about the Marxian contribution. So Karl Marx, you know that he has given, so certain fundamental thing we'll have to discuss about certain important concept first. Marxian theory, certain words you will have to understand. One is the organic composition of capital. So same thing, I'm reaching to the same one, how stationary state, we reach the stationary state, how declining is possible. So three or four or five important concepts I shall discuss about the Marxian theory, then we shall go on discussing the other part. So he mean Marx, he defined there are the two type of organic composition of capital. He has used organic composition of capital. Here he has referred two important concepts. One is called the constant capital, another is variable capital. So what is a constant capital? Constant capital means not only the fixed capital, all type of capital, for example, all the machinery, raw material, all these things are called the constant capital. Constant capital. Second type of capital is your variable capital, and variable capital means it is the labor. So according to him, organic composition of capital is the ratio of what he called the constant capital to the variable capital. Constant, the ratio between constant capital means the fixed machinery and another is your variable capital. Variable capital means this labor. The ratio between both the two is called the constant capital and the variable capital. Then another concept here we shall discuss, the very important, the heart of Marxian theory is your surplus value. Remember, this is a very important concept. What is a surplus value? So you know that suppose the output y equal to c mean the constant capital, b equal to the variable capital. So suppose it consists of two important concepts. So the total income is a constituent of three important view he has given. There is constant capital, variable capital, and another is your surplus value. I'm just giving some examples so that you can able to understand what is surplus value. Suppose you are a worker working in a factory, and for your subsistence level means it is the minimum amount of wages required to maintain your health and family and basic needs. That is your subsistence level. जाकु हम ओडिया रे कहबा सर्वनिम्न मौलिक आवश्यकता पूर्ण करबा पई जो परिमाण रो पूंजी बा अर्थ आवश्यक हुए ताको हम सबसिस्टेंस लेवल वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू फाइंड आउट द ओडिया वर्ड मिनिमम अमाउंट ऑफ मनी इज नेसेसरी फॉर एग्जांपल यू आर वर्किंग इन अ फैक्ट्री एंड यू आर वर्किंग फॉर 8 आवर अ डे एंड हियर to maintain your family the minimum amount of money required equal to 4 hour in 4 ghanta kaam kole nijara sarvanimna maulika avashyakata purana heuchi kintu company ba factory ame 8 ghanta kaam koruchu and the company owner he is paying you wages equal to 4 hour udaharan swarupa 100 taka पैसा आकार धर जो 100 टंका दिया होचे 100 टंका इक्वल टू 4 घंटा किंतु आमे काम करछु 8 घंटा आमे 200 टंका पाइबा कथा हमकु मिलुचे ओनली 100 टंका मीन अनदर 100 रुपीस दैट इज कॉल्ड द सरप्लस वैल्यू द एक्सेस अमाउंट ऑफ मनी दैट इज सेकंड बाय द एंटरप्रेन्योर और व्हाट कॉल्ड द कैपिटलिस्ट क्लास और द the what we call the haves class or what we call the bourgeois class so he is taking your 4 hour your 4 hour of labor value is taken by the enterprise and that is marks viewed as exploitation of labor ba shramiko ko shoshan and the labor the entrepreneur he has built his empire his capitalism or any what you call that is your contribution the exploitation made to the laborer that leads to remember that will build the capitalist empire mean ama pakru jo paisa sabu se nouchi honor se jan jan ko pakru chare suppose gute factory le 100 worker achante एवं जन जन ठार चार घंटा से नौ अर्थात 400 घंटार श्रम 400 घंटार श्रम से आम ठार नौ आमको किंतु ता बाबद पैसा दिया हो एंड दैट इज अदरवाइज द एक्सप्लोटेशन से ग्रेटर एंड ग्रेटर एक्सप्लोटेशन मोर एंड मोर एक्युमुलेशन ऑफ प्रॉफिट रिमेंबर मार्चेंट थ्योरी यू नो दैट देयर आर बिग 3 वॉल्यूम ऑफ बुक्स बट इट इज I shall complete within the given time of 5 or 10 minutes. It is not sufficient, but try to enter to the concept. So we have been exploited by the entrepreneur because he has taken our surplus value of the excess of earning what we are earning. So he has taken it. So there is another very important concept. Then, when accumulation of capital will take place, as we have discussed about the classical theory of in the classical theory of development so your labor that is going to the pocket of the entrepreneur or the haves class or the profit making class and they will get more and more quantity of profit and that will accumulate the capital accumulation is a primary concept but remember in view of getting more and more profit you know we are simply men we can at best we can work for 8 hour or 10 hour or 12 hour or maximum 14 hour you cannot work for 24 hour so what is his aim is you know that he has taken the test mana labhar swad se paichi so he is trying to exploit more and more of you and when there is more and more exploitation so automatically there will be dissatisfaction among the worker and they may put resistance of the trade union and other they may put resistance they may not work for 24 hour for you and when they do not work for 24 hour or 15 or let's say 20 hour then the capitalist will replace remember the capitalist will replace machine or what we call the constant capital in place of the variable capital means labor so instead of using more and more labor he will use more and more machine and the machine will now work and remember again I'm telling you cannot exploit the machine can work for 24 hour machine can work without any stop You cannot put a comma or push stop. Machine will work when it starts. Exploitation is possible only to the laborer, not to the machine. So in view of earning more and more and more profit, the capitalist or the enterprise class or the haves class or the bourgeois class, what we call, so they replace man to machine. I mean, instead of the variable capital, they will use more and more constant capital. And exploitation is now not possible. And the capitalist empire, what he has built, that will come to a standstill, again reach to a stationary state, and the economy will collapse. So remember, in view of getting more and more profit, he replaced machine to man, and when man is replaced by machine, automatically the process of profit will decline and the growth rate of the economy will come to an halt, and the economy will come to a situation what we call the stationary state, and the capitalism will collapse. So that is a type of view given by Marcel. But remember, Marxism, as you know, that it is a great philosophy of the time, like so famous, like any religious labor leader like your Jesus or Muhammad. But remember, much has been criticized. Many criticism are there. But many people view that Marx is a false prophet. Marx is a false prophet. His theory is not. But we have witnessed the earlier USSR or the China economy, that there is the socialist economy or the communist economy, that is based on, built on the principle of the philosophy of Marx. Or Marxism is still, it is ruling. And remember, Marxism or the theory of Marx will continue to lead till the end, because when there is a question of haves and have nots, there is a question of Marx. When there is a question of exploitation, there is a question of Marx. When there is a question of proletarian, bourgeois and proletariat, there is a question of Marx. So when there is a gap between the rich and poor, there is a question of Marx. And remember, Marx will continue to rule the world. As a student of economics, I do believe Marxism will continue to live, and Marx is still today is a prophet. But many revolution is taking place, new concept is taking place, but finally the Marxian theory of economic development, we have seen that the collapse of USSR earlier in late 90s, late 80s, in 1989, the USSR has been collapsed. Until China today, you know that it is based on the philosophy of your Marxism. They are also going to change their system. The state shall wither away. That is the view given by Marx. State shall wither away. But state is not withering away. New changes are taking place. The role of state has been maximized. Even in America or somewhere else, the role of state is giving important. But we are reaching to a mixed type of economy. The Marxism, the capitalism, in true sense, it is not possible, but it is going to prevail in the economy. So this is a concept, a separate type of discussion Professor Marx has made until his contribution is going on. Then we shall come across another very simple theory, a very popular theory, simple theory, what we call the Schumpeterian theory of economic development. So remember, Schumpeter, Joseph A. Schumpeter, he has given his own concept of economic development, and how the capitalism come to an end. He has given very clearly a very classical type of discussion he has made, and he has confirmed the classical economist. He has taken certain thing from the Marxian thought. And what the Schumpeterian theory of economic development tells, just remember. If you, Schumpeter, it is the development process of the economy takes place. Sorry, the development process of the economy takes place through innovation. Remember, the development process of the economy takes place through innovation. Just I'm making some clarification of certain words. One is invention and innovation. Invention, for example. Invention means, for example, Marconi invented radio, Gelbart invented television, or Colt invented revolver, or Alfred Nobel invented dynamite. That is invention. There is a scientific concept. A scientist innovate. But innovation is something different. Just take some example. Innovation is any activity which reduce the cost of production, any activity which reduce the cost of production and increase the revenue. And when a revenue goes up, cost come down. When the gap between the revenue and cost is highest, when more the revenue, less the cost, the rate of profit is more. So any activity which reduce the cost of production, remember, which reduce the cost of production and increase the revenue, that is called innovation. And innovation, you know that when we talk about the innovation can take place in different ways. For example, introduction of a new goods in the market. Suppose you are a entrepreneur. Remember another very popular word, entrepreneur and manager. Let me clarify the word. Entrepreneur is a person who innovates the things, and manager manages the things. Manager is a paid employee. Paid employee, he gets wages. And entrepreneur works for profit. So just I shall give the process of innovation, how it takes place. Introduction of a new goods to the market. Suppose you bring, you are one entrepreneur, suppose a mobile phone came to market, or let us say the fiber optic come to the market, or television, or your laptop. When introduction of a new goods to the market, so there is a first important question. Second, introduction of new source of new method of production, new method of production, new technique, introduction of new technique. Earlier, for example, something was produced with the help of labor, spinning jenny. heard about jenny. He innovated the thing, new machine has been introduced. And gotiye shramikare jaha kaam karau, 8ti shramikare jaha kaam karau hatla. ताकु जो दिया मैं गोटिये समय के लिए परिवर्तन करी परिवा आ बा मेसिन फॉर एग्जांपल आज के लिए जो रोड तैयारी हो सी यू आर यूजिंग मेसिन कौन सी पड़ा तो लुगा पड़ा हो बा अन्य कौन सी जगह रे मेसिन इज रिप्लेस बाय मैन सो व्हेन अ न्यू टेक्निक न्यू मेथड ऑफ प्रोडक्शन दैट टेक प्लेस फॉर एग्जांपल ग्रीन रिवॉल्यूशन इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ न्यू टेक्निक इन द प्रोडक्शन इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ योर ट्रैक्टर हार्वेस्टर पावर टिलर सो देयर इज ऑल्सो टाइप ऑफ इनोवेशन थर्ड इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन इज exploitation of a new market or finding out a new market. For example, today we are sitting the OSOU people, Dr. Asis, they are using the Meet app from this Google. There is an app developed by this particular company. Before this corona period, pre-corona ago, I'm also class classroom with a teacher was teaching, and today I'm teaching you through this F. So I am a new consumer. I am a new consumer of the Meet app or this Zoom app or what we call the TikTok somewhere else. So we are using the new market. We are the new consumer added to this market. So this company is earning more and more quantity of money. The fourth important question is that the use of new source of raw material. When raw material is used, new raw material is used, for example, use of rubber, for example, making of tire. Earlier, we were using the natural rubber. Today, you are using the synthetic rubber. So when synthetic rubber is used, there is a new type of raw material what we are using. And the fifth one, that the what we call the new type of organization. I mean, the from the individualistic company to the joint stock company or this share market concept, there is a new source of. So five concepts are there: introduction of new raw material, new technical production, new market, new consumer. So these are called the innovation. And when innovation takes place, the gap between the revenue and cost changes and profit arises. Just making a summary, more and more innovation. Entrepreneur is a man who innovates the thing. And when new innovation takes place, economic development is possible when there is more and more quantity of innovation. Got it, remember? Let us come to the economic development. How innovation is related to economic development. Remember that you are the entrepreneur, you are creating the gap, you are earning more and more profit, more and more quantity of income you are earning. And your economy, the process of economic development will go up and up. And again, I'm reaching to the stationary state, what the classical economists were telling. So remember, when you are one particular innovator, in course of time, everybody will follow you. Everybody will follow you. If everybody will follow you, the copy and paste technology, what we call, then rate of profit will decline. If everybody is producing same thing, everybody is following the same type of technology, then automatically the concept of profit will decline. Competition will take place, and when higher and higher competition takes place, automatically level of profit will decline. So this is a very interesting concept. But remember what Schumpeter viewed, that the swarm-like future, he used a swarm-like feature. Swarm-like feature means that hansa kudi udi jauchi aa baki samaste tanko jenti follow kare. If everybody will follow the same path, there is nothing new in the process of innovation. But remember, entrepreneur is a man who will not sleep idle. He innovates and innovates. And when more and more innovation takes place, the economic development, which come to an end due to this copy of innovation, again, this process of economic development will take place when new and new innovation will take place. So innovation is a primary thing which determines the concept of economic development. Greater and greater innovation, more and more innovation. And remember, he viewed very important question, where will get the money? Where will get the capital? And according to Schumpeter, it is the banks. It is the banks who has to finance. It is the banks who has to finance the entrepreneur. But remember, when he is earning more and more quantity of profit, more and more amount of profit, the entrepreneur is earning, he will try to return back the money, the principal and interest, and the old industry will die. Soon, the new industry will follow the path, and he viewed that the capitalist buried his own dick. Mana nijo gato se nije khole, ebang dhire dhire capitalism ba punjibatra dhonsa hoye bole Schumpeter. Yes, he is a supporter of what we call the capitalism. But if you economic development, dhire dhire akko jibo business cycle, innovation akko nebo stationary state asibo. Stationary state pore ba gote sthita avastha ba sthira avastha pore dhire dhire puni avakkhya hobo. Avakkhya ru puni entrepreneur or the man, the innovators will come to the market, and one innovator come to the market, economic development will again take place. So this is a circle is complete, and that is the view given by Schumpeter. So remember, here The whole concept I told you is divided into three parts. Today's the three modules, that is the unit 15, 16, 17, that is divided into three parts. This is the first part. The theories of economic development. Me gote economy ba gote arthanita bikas ki pari hoye aku ki pari jaye ki pari bhabre tolku ase puni ki pari bhabre utthan upar ko jaye amme we have discussed this thing in three version. One is called the classical version, that is led by Adam Smith and others. Second one is your this Schumpeterian concept, a Marxian concept, and the third one is Schumpeterian concept. So the economy, that it will increase, it reaches to the maximum, then it falls, rising, maximum in that the stationary state, then the decline, puni dhire dhire upko jibo. So this is a process of economic development, or a cycle is complete. But this is one part. Now we shall come into the second important part. That is very interesting and very effective one. First, we'll have to understand here, that particularly this is a theory which is related to underdeveloped country, economic development of the developing country, poor country, how economic development is taking place. Here, we shall discuss a very interesting thing, and what you know everybody, that the vicious circle of poverty. First question, the theory part is over. Now we shall discuss the vicious circle of poverty. Then after the vicious circle of poverty, we shall discuss about what are the causes, or what are the obstacle to economic development. Why economic development is not taking place in the underdeveloped country, or what are the fundamental problem of underdeveloped country. And the third part of the discussion, we shall discuss how to break the vicious circle of poverty. So three important concepts, dear student, just follow: the process of economic development, the vicious circle of poverty, and the third one is how to break the vicious circle of poverty, how to overcome the vicious circle of poverty. So now we shall discuss about the concept of vicious circle of poverty. You know, very, very popular concept. Here, one famous economist, Ragnar R. Norse. He is a famous economist. He has given the concept of vicious circle of poverty. And remember, according to him, a vicious circle of poverty implies a circular constellation of forces. Remember the word. A circular constellation of forces tending to act and react upon each other in such a way. गोटे वृत्त आकार जिनिष बा किसी कारण एपरी भाव से माने काम करते दे act and react in such a way as to keep a poor country in the state of poverty. Remember, according to Norse, a country is poor because it is poor. A country is poor because it is gotte desa gariba karana eha garibat. So garibira karana garib. And now we shall discuss why a poor country is poor country. Why is this country is a rich country? According to Norse, so we shall identify three important concepts of BCP, or I'm just using the word BCP, mean the vicious circle of poverty. Remember, just keep your mind here, very interesting and very important concept. There are three such vicious circle of poverty identified by Professor Norse. Suppose a poor country, that is an underdeveloped country. One is demand side, supply side, market, three type of things we shall discuss. A poor country, or if suppose a country is underdeveloped one. In an underdeveloped country, the productivity capacity is very less. In an underdeveloped country, the productivity capacity is very low productivity. When there is a low productivity, there is a low income of the people, or what we call the low rural income. When the income level is less, when productivity is less, income is less, when income is less, saving is less, when there is no saving or there is a less saving, investment is less. So when there is no investment, there is a shortage of capital or capital deficiency, and due to deficiency of capital, your country is a poor. I'm just repeating, a poor country, less income, less productivity, less saving, less investment, less capital, less employment, less development. So this is called one side, the supply side of the vicious cycle. Another side we shall discuss. Suppose a country is a poor, productivity is less, income is less. When your income is less, the demand is very less. When your income is less, suppose you do not have income. When your income is less, your demand is very less. When there is no demand, suppose nobody is purchasing a product, then there will be no investment. When there is no investment, there is a shortage of capital, capital deficiency. When there is a capital deficiency, again, there is no production. When there is no production, there is no employment. When there is no employment, there is no income. So your country is poor. It means a country is poor because it is poor. A country is rich. Suppose Japan is rich. Why Japan is rich? Because Japan is rich. How it is? Japan is rich, more income, more saving, more capital, more investment, more production, more employment, more income. Suppose India is poor, less income, less saving, less capital, less investment, less production, less employment, income is less. So according to this theory, one very, very fundamental thing which is responsible for poverty of a country is the working of the vicious circle of poverty. Vicious circle is just like a tights the hand. One of the causes which is responsible for underdevelopment, another concept he has discussed, that in an underdeveloped country, the resources is poor. Less, suppose India is a very rich country, but the people are poor. India is a rich country, but the people are, why? We have rich natural resources. We have sufficient amount of water resources, forest resources, yeah, beneath the earth, we have coal, or we have deposit of everything. But finally, people are backward. We are, either our resources is unutilized, underutilized, misutilized. So we come to this concept of vicious circle of poverty. So gote desare garibiro mukhya karana garibi ebong garibi kahi ki garibi hoche karan ama pakare income kom ache, the income level is very less. One second. Sorry, student for disturbance. Anyway, so yeah, now we shall comment to the another very important concept, that poverty is the cause of poverty. So question is, how to break the vicious circle of poverty? Without breaking the vicious circle of poverty, economic development is not possible. So what is our ambition? Our ambition of study of this paper is what? That we have to break the vicious circle of poverty. One of the reason for economic underdevelopment is vicious circle of poverty. And your intention of study is what? How to break the vicious circle of poverty? So different economists, different about, you know, that you will find hundreds of theories are there to break the vicious circle of poverty. Different groups of economists are there, like, for example, Rhodes and Rodin, Norstre, Nelson, Lewis, many models are there, and they have viewed their opinion related to how to break the vicious circle of poverty. And what are the different theories available to break the vicious circle of poverty? I mean, how economic development is possible, or how we can able to break the vicious circle of poverty. So we shall discuss here some important theories, though all theories are not in your course. We shall discuss certain selected theory here. One is called the Big Push theory. Very important, very interesting theory that is given by Professor Powell and Rodestin Rodin. Rodestin Rodin, in 1943, he has given a very popular theory that is called the Big Push theory. What is a Big Push theory? According to this theory, a large comprehensive program is necessary in the form of high minimum amount of investment. According to this theory, a good investment or a sizable investment or a huge investment is necessary to launch the underdeveloped economy in the path of growth. And to him, quote, launching a country into self-sustaining growth, a little like getting an aeroplane off the ground. उदाहरण स्वरूप गोटे उड़ाजहाज जितने ऊपर को जाए उड़ाजहाज जितने टेकअप हुए ऊपर को जाए ए मिनिमम ग्राउंड स्पीड इज नेसेसरी जोर रह जाए तापर देन इट बिकम द एयरबोर्न आमे अकॉर्डिंग टू रोडेन दैट ए बीट बाय बीट or the addition of bit by bit will not equal to a single byte. Mane gude economic development koriba kohile amko the comprehensive investment in many sectors is necessary. Udan sorpo sitamasare jetele gude udan sorpo gude tractor gude bus ase apan man dekhitebe jetele gude thanda aiyetibo ताकू गुडे ठेली के गुडे धक्का दला परे जोर रे धक्का दला परे ऑटोमेटिकली स्टार्ट हो जाए गुडे जोर धक्का तो बिग पुश थ्योरी इज अ सिंगल लाइन थ्योरी वन लाइन थ्योरी एंड व्हाट इज दैट ए बिग इन्वेस्टमेंट इज ए बिग और ए ह्यूज इन्वेस्टमेंट इज नेसेसरी एंड व्हेन ए ह्यूज इन्वेस्टमेंट इज मेड ऑटोमेटिकली द इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट इज पॉसिबल एनी जस्टिफाइड हिज थ्योरी through the concept of indivisibility or a certain thing if you production individual you know that externalities some effect for example the production function is indivisible udan sab gude machine gude steel plant karibar ache a huge investment a small steel plant is not possible गोटे माइक्रो साइज रोटे स्टिल प्लांट नब माइक्रो साइज मेसीन इज नट पसबल ए ह्यूज इनमेंटमेंट प्रडक्शन फंक्शन यू नो दैट यू हैव टू परचेज द मेसीन एज ए होल ए पार्ट ऑफ द मेसीन इज नॉट गोइंग टू गिव यू एनी प्रडक्शन डिसीजन सेकेंड इंपोर्टेंट क्वेश्चन इज दैट इंडिविजिबिलिटी ऑफ डिमांड एंड वन मेनी एंड मेनी इंडस्ट्रीज रोडेस्टन रोडन इन इज अनबैलेंस बैलेंस ग्रोथ थ्योरी एज व्यूड when we invest in many sector 1 2 3 4 5 many sectors then demand will come from every side for example suppose there is a suit industry suppose there is a construction of suit industry only one industry is there I mean the wage earner or the worker in the suit industry at the end of the month when they get the salary they will not purchase only suits they have to purchase many things they have to purchase the gold or silver or let me say motor bike or garments or many thing or hotel many investment they have to make so according to Rodin when investment is made in all the sectors mean a big investment is taking place in all the primary sector secondary sector tertiary sector then when automatically all the economy all the industries will run माने आम जब केवल गोटे इंडस्ट्री गोटे शिल्प में किसी पैसा खर्च कर तार कौन रेजल्ट आसना जदि बहुत गुड़े सेक्टर में खर्च करा जाए समस्ते समस्त जिनस किणवे उदाहरण स्वरूप ये वर्कर इन ए स्टील प्लांट ना तुमको सीमेंट दरकार अच्छे यू विल परचेज सीमेंट पर्सन विज वर्किंग द सीमेंट प्लांट कपड़ा दरकार अच्छे यू विल परचेज क्लॉथ सो एवरीबॉडी विल परचेज एवरीबॉडीज प्रोडक्ट the aggregate demand of the economy will go up and when more and more demand is taking place automatically economic development is possible similarly you know that so you know that many indivisibilities are taking place in the economy there are two important factor of production and the demand side two important indivisibility are there So big investment is necessary for economic development of underdeveloped country. So one line theory, just remember, but a short investment kichi kaam debo nahi. If we invest a good quantity, heavy quantity of money, all the selected sector, all the sectors, automatically economic development will take place. But this is a very interesting theory. But remember, for the underdeveloped country, the main criticism of the theory is that we are poor country. It is very difficult for us to arrange a particular thing. So if we advise you, nay, invest in all the sector of the economy, where you will get the money? Where you will get the money? Second important question is, we do not have so much of infrastructure. For example, in the unbalanced growth theory, his many view that you have to create the social overhead capital and direct productivity activity. Road infrastructure is necessary, education is necessary, health is necessary, communication is necessary. And if somebody will suggest you know, invest in all the sector today, where you will get the money? Today we are facing, for example, this post-corona effect. We have seen how our prime minister, our chief minister, our finance minister, they are very worried. Many economists have suggested that you invest in primary sector, secondary sector, tertiary sector, all these sector, simultaneous investment in all these sector is necessary so that economic development is possible. But question is, we are a very poor country. Where to get the money? We do not have so much of infrastructure, shortage of infrastructure. We cannot create the demand exactly for the people. And that's the reason this theory is not applicable to underdeveloped country, because we have a problem like this. So the in the same line, we shall discuss the another very small theory, two-line theory. The theory of critical minimum effort. You know that Livingston, another very popular economist, he viewed according to him, there is a direct correlation between two important questions. One is per capita income, population growth, and investment. Per capita income, population growth, and investment. And according to Livingston, the growth of an economy is possible when the income generating factor, remember, the income generating factor turn out to be more powerful than the income depressing factor. Remember, I'm just using two words. When the income generating factor means investment. When the income generating factor is more powerful than the income depressing factor, mean the population. When the investment level is higher than, follow me, when the level of investment is higher than the level of the population, the growth of population, then economic development is possible. So according to this theory, when some investment is made, according to Livingston, in the critical minimum effort, he viewed a very small rise in the income. Suppose income rises by 2%, but your population is rising by 3%. A small rise in the income, that is not going to help you. The people, those who are the new population, they will eat everything. They will consume everything. So according to this theory, when the per capita income over a period of time rises greater than the level of population, remember, that is called the critical minimum effort. If you not reach to a particular state, particular area, then economic development will not go on. The same theory, I'm just giving this aeroplane. धीरे धीरे गले से आपको जाई परबो नै ए क्रिटिकल मिनिमम लाइक द बिग पुश थ्योरी गुटे गुटे मिनिमम ग्राउंड स्पीड इज नेसेसरी सिमिलरली व्हेन द रेट ऑफ पर कैपिटा इनकम इज ग्रेटर देन द रेट ऑफ ग्रोथ ऑफ पॉपुलेशन देन इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट इज पॉसिबल माने खाली अल्प इन्वेस्टमेंट कर देले बा गोटे के जोड़े सेक्टर रे किछि जदी इन्वेस्ट कर देले ता कोनोसी प्रकार फायदा देबो नाही हमको गोटे हेवी इन्वेस्टमेंट इज नेसेसरी एंड इफ यू दैट फॉर एग्जांपल अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस लिविंगस्टन that there are certain factor of production which are indivisible. You cannot purchase half of the machine because machine is indivisible. You can purchase half of this, half kg of sugar. You can purchase one quintal sugar, but you cannot purchase half of the television. Half of your mobile phone is not a phone. 30% of your shoes is not a shoe. Whole is necessary. So there are some machines you have to purchase the whole, a part is not going to help you. So that's the reason a heavy investment is necessary. Then there are certain factors which are mutually interdependent upon one another. For example, farm and industry. For example, this consumer and producer, they are mutually dependent upon one. When there is a consumption, there is production. When there is production, there is consumption. So that both will generate the income. So a critical minimum investment is necessary. Unless and until we invest a huge sum of money, a good quantity of money, economic development is not possible. So there is another very important concept. One line theory, just like the Big Push theory. It is just like the Big Push theory. Big Push theory tells you a heavy investment is necessary so that economic development is possible. And this critical minimum effort theory tells you without a minimum level of investment, we cannot overcome the problem of your population. And when the investment level is much higher than the growth rate of population, when the investment rate is more or greater than the level of that is the growth, economic development is possible. Otherwise, it is not possible. So that is called the critical minimum. Again, the same criticism. In the underdeveloped country, where you will get the money? We do not have so much of infrastructure. We do not have, in a country where there is a dualistic nature of economy, like India, for example, rural area, urban area, huge population in the living in the village area, they are not getting the basic needs. There is no other facilities are there. The demand is also not good. In such a situation, thinking of such a need, that is a critical minimum effort or a big investment or a big put investment, it is not at all justified. It is. They don't agree with that, and that is the reason his many view investment in a particular sector, selected sector, is very important. You invest in a selected sector, you create the tension in the economy, you create the different type of effect in the economy, so that economic development is possible. In the same line, another theory has been developed by that is Nelson, R.R. Nelson, Professor R.R. Nelson, 1950s. He has given a very important, interesting theory, a small theory. There is a low-level equilibrium trap theory. Low level of equilibrium trap. So this is the theory which is more or less related to T.R. Malthus. How it is related? Trap. Trap line, you might have heard about debt trap, population trap. Put a trap line, put a line. So what the theory is telling, there are three stages of demographic transition. He linked, Professor Nelson, he linked his theory with the theory of demographic transition. In the demographic transition, we have discussed earlier, there are three stages. In the first stage, high birth rate, high death rate. When the country is a very poor country, like African country today or India before independent, the birth rate is high, the death rate is high, the net growth rate of population is very less, the per capita income is very less. In the second stage, when economic development takes place, the population explosion takes place. Here we reach, my point of discussion is, when the income graph or the income curve is above the population curve. In the beginning stage, the population curve is above the income curve. In the second stage, the population, there is the income curve is when the, it is greater than the population curve or population graph. My point of discussion is, suppose income is growing at a rate of 10%, GDP is rising at a 10%, population is rising at a rate of 5%. So there is a gap of 5%. And that is otherwise known as the concept of the equilibrium trap. When we reach a situation, after that particular situation, when the income exceeds the growth rate of the population, then economic development is possible. And in the developed country, like almost European countries, we have seen such a situation where their income rate of growth of income is many more times greater than the rate of growth of population. And they have overcome the critical minimum effort. गोटे निर्दिष्ट सीमा को से माने ऑलरेडी कवर्ड पहुंची सारे एवं वर्तमान पर्यंत टिल नाउ आम देश इंडिया बांग्लादेश सम आर दि पुअर कंट्रीज जदिओ आम अनेक समय आगे जाऊ बट वी आर अनेबल टू कवर द क्रिटिकल मिनिमम उदाहरण स्वरूप गोटे स्पीड ए मिनिमम स्पीड आमको इकोनोमी धरे ना तेणु लिवेनस्टीन कहते गोटे क्रिटिकल मिनिमम एफर्ट को पार कले क्रिटिकल मिनिमम पॉइंट को पार कले जिते बेले पर कैपिटा जीडीपी रियल जीडीपी जनसंख्या ठीक अधिक आकार बढ़ देन इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट इज पॉसिबल सो टू टाइप ऑफ थिंग आर देयर वन इज द पॉपुलेशन कर्व एंड अदर इज कॉल्ड द इनकम कर्व व्हेन द इनकम कर्व इज अहेड ऑफ व्हेन द इनकम कर्व इज अहेड ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन कर्व then development economic and we can able to break the vicious circle of poverty. Remember, we are discussing that very particular thing, that how to break the vicious circle of poverty. So we have to overcome the difficulties. What type of difficulties? The difficulties which is related to the vicious circle of poverty. We have to break the vicious circle only when the income level is greater than the population. So that is another very interesting view that was given by Professor Nelson. Then some other small concept like some dualistic concept has been given, that social dualism, technological dualism. Another very bit by bit, just I'm referring another very small theory, one line theory that is developed by Professor Book, G.H. Book. He viewed that in the underdeveloped country there is a social dualism. Let me understand what is dualistic character. For example, in India, the basic characteristic of Indian economy is a dualistic nature. Dualistic means there is a high developed economy means, for example, Mumbai, Calcutta, Delhi, Bangalore, they are very developed. Some states are also very developed, but we have also underdeveloped part, like, for example, the rural part of our country. In a country where there is a coexistence of both the things, there is a high developed industrial sector and very poor agrarian sector. Bikashita vithiva, abikashita vithiva. Both factors. I mean, in the economy, when there is, you have seen the jet plane is there also in our country, and bullock cart is also are there. So economy where you have the bullock cart, as well as the jet plane. When both the things are available, that is called a dual character, or what we call the dualistic economy. So let me say how it is defined. The dual society in the underdeveloped country, you know that there is a dual society. We refer to the society showing a distinct cleavage of two synchronized and full grown social style. Two type of styles are there. If we evaluate the history, that the standard of living, the way of thinking, the level of education of some people is different from another people. Some are, for example, the people of Mumbai, they are thinking different from the people of your Burgod and Samalpur or Dachoda. The people of your urban area, their thought is different from the people of your rural area. So we have a dual character. I mean, there is an existence of this what we call the Eastern society. Mana Prachya and Pascha. Mana Eastern society culture. Are there modern, what we call the existence of modern and traditional. So in a society, when there is a coexistence of the modern and the traditional concept of society, economic development is a hindrance. And according to book, we have to break it. The dualistic character. I mean, in a society, when there is a dualistic character, if we are able to break the dualistic character of the economy, economic development is possible. And till there is a dualistic nature, I mean, some people are very developed and some people are very, very poor. In such a situation, you know, economic development is not possible. So we have to break the dualistic nature of the society or the social dualism. Without breaking this, economic development is not possible. So there is one question. Another question that there is another theory, the same Benjamin Higgins. He viewed that there is a technological dualism. So the same thing I'm referring. Technological dualism means what? That it implies the use of different production functions in the advanced sector and in the traditional sector. Mane jo jagare, jo desare, jo samare, jo nirdishta samare, ame gote advanced technology and very poor technology. Ubha technology byabahar kortuba, taku technological dualism boli kuhajae. Mean we are using a very supersonic technology, as I have given the earlier, that we have a jet plane technology, we have also pull-up car technology. So this is a two type of existence of two type of or let us say plying of land or holonongol bolodre chas kariba type of chas kariba. So which are two type of production function available in advanced sector, industrial sector. They are using advanced technology, modern technology, high-fi technology, or what we call the computer technology, but in the village area, in the rural area, many traditional industries are there. They are using a very poor, very the classical type of technology. So according to this theory, Higgins, that when there is a existence of, when there is a presence of, yeah, existence of this concept, concept of your dualistic character of the economy, economic development is not possible. And a homogeneous type of technology is required. Same like the socialistic or the dualism, when a homogeneity is there, same type of technology is there, same type of social character is there, we can able to break the vicious circle of poverty. And without breaking the vicious circle of poverty, economic development is not possible. And now we shall come to the last part of the discussion. That is another very popular theory given by Professor Arthur Lewis, W. Lewis. He has given a very interesting theory. And according to Professor Lewis, or that is popularly known as Lewis model of economic development, or the two model of economic development. Here, just I'm making it quickly due to time crisis. Look at it. If you that in the underdeveloped country, there exists a large reserve of labor force. In the underdeveloped country like India, then which we have a huge quantity of labor force. And most of the labor force, supply of labor is unlimited. This is also unlimited supply of labor theory. Lewis theory is known as unlimited labor supply theory. We have a huge quantity of labor force. But the question is, the marginal productivity of the labor, the marginal productivity of the labor is very less. So there is a surplus labor. Most of the labor is underdeveloped, unemployed in our economy, unemployed, underemployed, this guy is unemployed, technically unemployed, seasonally unemployed. We have a huge gap between the demand of labor and the supply of labor is more than the demand of labor, and majority of the laborer of our economy are almost all unemployed type of labor. So according to Lewis, if we can able to utilize the huge supply of labor into a productive channel, automatically economic development is possible. His model is also the same, like unlimited supply of labor. Labor force is to be transferred into the most important, the driving force of the economy. It will drive them in a very better way. Economic development is possible. Similarly, some other theories are there. The Harris theory, Tedo theory. But two or three things I want to tell you. That most of the underdeveloped countries, they are facing the problem of vicious circle of poverty. Without breaking the vicious circle of poverty, economic development is not possible. And the latest theory of what I've discussed, the Lewis model or any other model, that tells you how to break the vicious circle of poverty. The first part tells you how economic development takes place. The second part tells you what are the hindrance in the way of economic development, or that what we call the vicious circle of poverty, VCP, and the models that explain how to break the vicious circle, the views given by different economists. This is, though you know that your time is constant, I don't think I've given true justice to you for your understanding because of constraint of time. However, as the time permits, thank you, dear friends, for patiently listening me about 1.5 hours. Thank you, Dr. Ashish, coordinator. Thank you, all the members of OSOU. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to interact with most of the young friends. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Sir, can we take a few questions from our learners?
Okay.
If they have, yeah. So learners may ask some questions if they have. What is cultural and economic inertia according to Nelson?
So one thing that according to Nelson, he viewed that most of the underdeveloped country, one of the hindrance is the cultural, that is, there is no homogeneity in the society. In a country like us, we are facing such a situation, cultural, or what we may call the cultural hindrance. Hundreds of, আমি যদি ওড়িয়ারে কহিবা 12 মাসরে 25 পড়ব ওকে সো দিস আর সাম হিন্ড্রেন্স ইন দ্য ওয়ে অফ ইকোনমিক ডেভেলপমেন্ট এন্ড ইট ইজ মোস্টলি সিন সামবডি টোল দ্যাট দ্য হিন্দু রেট অফ গ্রোথ ইজ ওয়ান অফ দ্য মোস্ট ইম্পর্টেন্ট ইজ অন দ্য কালচারাল ইনার্টিয়া দ্যাট ইজ রেসপন্সিবল ফর দ্য হিন্দু রেট অফ গ্রোথ ওয়াট রিয়েলি আশিস ক্যান এক্সপ্লেইন দিস থিং ইন আ বেটার ওয়ে
এনি আদার কোশ্চেনস Okay, sir, thank you. And then it was a nice session. You have discussed the growth theories, starting from the vicious circle of poverty and how it is difficult to come out of this vicious circle of poverty, and why economies are not able to the circle of poverty. And then what are the ways out and how different theories, starting from classical and then the Schumpeterian theory and the subsequent theories of Lewis and then Harris Todaro model, etc., guide us to come out from this vicious circle of poverty, and what are they offered to us, and what is that an economics or the policy makers should do. We have got a broad picture. What are the options available in our hand to take the economy out of this vicious circle of poverty, and what is that an economist can do or the government can do? Yes, we have discussed about capital accumulation, how it contributes to economic growth, the rent, the population, the workforce, the surplus saving, the big push investment, the critical minimum effort, and then we have also discussed the dualistic characteristic and how we have to break the dualism, both social dualism as well as the technological dualism and the critical minimum effort, etc., to bring the economy to the growth path. We have also discussed the Marx contributions. Actually, according to Marc Bloch, blood pressure goes up when Marx is under examination. Hope we have our blood pressure intact. The capital accumulation is basically through the exploitation of labor and accumulation of surplus through exploiting the laborers. And then, therefore, there is a danger of getting into a conflict, and then so capitalism may dig its own hole. Subsequently, we have also discussed about the Schumpeterian theory and then the role of innovation in economic growth. Innovation is basically the application of the invention. It is nothing but the act of enhancing the profit, either by reducing cost or by increasing revenue. However, it is in itself not adequate. An economy to grow, there is a requirement of continuous innovation, because once a innovation happens, it is very easy for other firms to copy and replicate. Therefore, new products, new methods of competitions, they compete with old, not in an equal term, but as a decisive advantage that they may mean death to the latter. That means the old will die as a result of the new innovation. Capitalism destroys the old and creates the new one. Therefore, capitalism can be termed as creative destruction. Then we discussed about the big push theory, the large scale investment in multiple sectors simultaneously. Each industry will become and complementary to each other under such a conditions. And there is a role of government that is required, because big push investment is not a matter of job. No single individual or firm can undertake that. So simultaneously investing in multiple sector requires the role of government, different from what Adam Smith was talking about, where let the individual go alone or laissez-faire economy. Here, the investment in infrastructure requires the role of government. And then there is also discussions about the critical minimum effort and the low-level equilibrium threat. So on the whole, we could complete the entire theories of development to get a bird's eye view or a complete picture what is there in our hand to bring the economy out of the vicious circle of poverty. Thank you a lot, sir. Our learners, I'm sure, would have got benefited from this session. And we'll see you soon in subsequent sessions. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
One more minute. Minati. Minati or Runita? Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Aziz.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.